afternoon. No, thank you very much for coming. This is actually quite an impressive audience. Many people have been asking me, maybe just before I get into it, why we are here. I would like to acknowledge the presence of the President of the University of Johannesburg Convocation. If you can stand so that you are seen. And also I would like to acknowledge the presence of my co-author, Dr. Evan Hurwitz. If you can stand up so that you can be seen. Evan and I have worked together for a very long time. He was my master's student. When I was at the other university in Johannesburg, and when I moved to the University of Johannesburg, he actually followed me. So he is our alumni. He did a PhD here at the University of Johannesburg. We have worked together for quite a while. I remember at one stage, we appeared on the magazine, The New Scientist. And when we appeared in The New Scientist, I was in China. So I went and took a copy of the Chinese version of The New Scientist just to see how my name is written. Unfortunately, in that article, everything else was in Chinese characters, except my name. I also would like to acknowledge the presence of some of my PhDs are here. Elias, if you can stand to receive also. That's my PhD. Now, many of you know that my vision is really to take the University of Johannesburg into the fourth industrial age. And at the heart of the fourth industrial age is multidisciplinary education. And I think this is probably something that I actually picked up when I was an undergraduate student in Auckland. So I was a mechanical engineering student. So I arrived in the United States this year. On top of all these mechanical engineering courses, you will have to take 10 semesters of humanities. I couldn't understand it. So I did take 5 semesters of economics. So the reason why I have been so interested in economics is actually because I actually studied it as an undergraduate, 5 semesters of it. I also studied 2 semesters of acting. So acting is another career that I would pursue if this thing of being a vice chancellor does not work out. I also studied 2 semesters of psychology. And I studied the history of South Africa. I mean, how does a mechanical engineer in Cleveland, Ohio, studies history of South Africa, which is full of students? You know, this is what we need to see more and more as we move into the fourth industrial revolution, to see more people in humanities taking technology modules, and people in technology to take courses in humanities. So this is basically a book, Artificial Intelligence and Economic Theory, Skynet in the Market. What does it attempt to do? It reviews how Nobel Prize winning economic ideas are actually changed by the advances of artificial intelligence. And of course, it enriches understanding of financial markets in the age of artificial intelligence. For those of you who are old enough, you remember when the stock market was still in downtown Johannesburg. And you will see it on TV, people screaming and shouting. In fact, to work for the stock market, you know, there were 2 characteristics that were very key. One, you had to be tall. And the reason for that, so that when you are calling a stock, people should be able to see you. And the second criteria was that you have to have a commanding voice. You know, if you have a softer voice, nobody is going to hear you. But the stock market has moved on, you know, it is in Central City, it's very quiet. You won't even see anybody at the stock floor. So things have changed. And of course, that has implications for many big ideas that have been proposed, and I will talk about this in this case, the efficient market hypothesis. And obviously, I will talk about some of the applications that we have dealt with. So this is a picture of a robot that I visited in South Korea. This is the same robot. Look, it is driving. It gets out of the car. It can walk. It can do a little bit of modeling, as you can see. Then he realizes that walking is not efficient, then it lies. And he's looking around this, and he comes to a door, looks around, and it opens the door. Then it does a little bit of mechanical engineering. Is very satisfied that it has done what it's supposed to do. Then it looks at four devices. It's thinking a little bit. Processing speed is actually quite key in robotics. And it throws one, then it stops for no other reason. It's thinking a little bit. Then it picks a drill, and it actually drills. It's almost like a human being, isn't it? This is what we call artificial intelligence. And robotics is just one aspect of artificial intelligence. And you know, the title Skynet in the market, I don't know how many of you have watched the movie The Terminator. Skynet obviously was one of the subjects in The Terminator. And much of this work you can find in our book that I wrote with Professor Bo Shin. Smart maintenance for human-robot interaction. Now, before we get into how artificial intelligence is going to change economic theory, I think let's just first understand what artificial intelligence is all about. Artificial intelligence is actually inspired by what we observe in nature. And there is an anonymous saying that says that nature is the best artist. Learn from it. And that's really what we do in artificial intelligence. We look at how nature does what it is supposed to do, and we learn from that. Now, artificial intelligence, artificial means man-made, intelligence means processing information beyond the obvious. So it's basically a process of codifying intelligence into machines. And hopefully those machines are actually used to solve practical problems that actually matter. Of course, there is quite a great deal of computer science because it has to be programmed, and there's also a great deal of mathematics. Now, in artificial intelligence, we distinguish between two types of intelligence. One is group intelligence. You can see this, the school of fish, you know, a multiple braids. That's another way in which you can look at. And on the left-hand side is individual intelligence, like, you know, an individual with a brain. And this interplay between individual intelligence and group intelligence are something that we are going to explore a little bit further. And it's quite useful in artificial intelligence. One aspect of what artificial intelligence is learning. How do you make machines learn from their environment? And one way of doing this is what we call a neural network. You can see on one side is a real neuron from that we see in human brains. On the other side is an artificial neuron. So what can we do? On the bottom, these are input that are connected to form an output. So the input can be the weather in the last 3 days, and the output can be the weather next week. Then it will become a predictor of the weather. And you can actually be able to build these neural networks to be so complicated that they can be able to do complicated tasks, such as looking at images of people and be able to identify who they are. Facebook has an application when you post a picture, they're actually able to label who the person is. And it actually uses neural networks. And the second aspect about artificial intelligence is what we call optimization. It's a bombastic word. You know, if you wanted to move from here to certain city in the shortest possible time, in mathematics we call that an optimization problem. It is an optimization problem because it seeks to minimize the distance. You know, if you wanted to find out who is the tallest person in the world, that process of finding who is the tallest person in the world, if you are going to do it mathematically, is what we call optimization. And there are many, if you look at nature, there are many systems that have perfected the art of optimization. For example, at the top is a picture of an ant mold. I actually took this picture when I was going home in Limpopo. Lots of ant molds. And from the way they work, we are actually able to design algorithms for optimization. And one such algorithm is called ant colony optimization. And the whole concept of ant intelligence was actually developed in South Africa and was published in Haskell and Watt many years ago, more than 100 years ago. In fact, the person who actually came up with these ideas, understanding how the group intelligence work here, is I think he's an Afrikaans writer called Eugene Marie. He wrote a book called The Silver Lining, which is really a standard textbook on colony optimization. And you can be able to use this, and some of you might have observed ants forming a straight line, you know, in your houses. It turns out that that line that they are following is actually the shortest distance from their nest to the food source. Now, you can imagine if we can be able to codify that, and we are able to do that, then we can be able to use it for our GPSs, to be able to find shortest path that we should take. You know? So this is really another aspect of artificial intelligence that we do. The other one, this is called particle swarm optimization. I think the economists call this the invisible hand. That was Adam Smith who came up with the concept of the invisible hand. You cannot see who is guiding this bird. You know, wherever this person is going, they seem to follow. How do they do it? Of course, now we know how they do it. It's actually an interplay between individual intelligence that I've talked about and group intelligence. How do they get group intelligence? They just look at what their neighbor is doing, and individually they know where they have been before, and then they use those two characteristics to find out where the food source is. And particle swarm optimization is obviously quite a popular optimization technique. It is able to solve a standard problem in optimization called the salesman problem, where they take 50 cities in the United States and say, can you visit all of them in the shortest possible time? How would you do that? And just by taking this and codifying it, you are able to solve that. Actually quite a difficult problem to solve. If we were just to study it in economic terms, the invisible hand context you can be able to see here is almost guided. The concept of utilitarianism come in because each bank is trying to maximize its utility. We obviously have to have a utility function, which sometimes we call it an objective function. Now, how does all this that I've talked about, artificial intelligence, actually change economic theory? So I'm going to go over about 10 economic theories and how they are changed by artificial intelligence. The first one I'm going to talk about is the very old theory, demand and supply. Demand and supply concept actually originated in the Middle East in the 1400s. When I was studying economics, I thought it originated in Europe. It actually originated much, much earlier than that. We have found evidence that an Arab scholar actually came up with the concept of demand and supply. Now, what is the demand and supply? The demand is, we all know that if the price is high, the demand is low, and if the price is low, the demand is high. And then the supply is on the other side. And when you go to pick and pay, to buy a particular good and services, you are subjected to the aggregate demand and supply. So what you see there, where they meet, is an equilibrium price, and that is what many people are going to use as a source of the price of a good and service. So when you go to pick and pay, there is a price. And that price comes from the aggregate demand and aggregate supply of that particular good, and when they meet, you have a price. But if you go to, let's say, a market in New Delhi, and I've been there many times, and you see a good, it does not have a price. You actually have to bargain for the price. What is that seller trying to do? He is actually trying to get your demand curve. And based on his estimation of the demand curve, they will give you a price. And that is why if you go to such markets, the same good will be sold at different prices in the same day, sometimes within a few minutes of one another. Now, what happens now? We are buying and selling on the internet. And I think Amazon is a classic example where they are able to understand you using artificial intelligence engines, and they are able to build your individual demand and demand curve. And what happens? Now we are able to individually price goods and services. So that is why, if you go to these online buying platforms, again, it's almost like a market, a free market. You know, a book. I have gone and looked for two prices of price of a book, almost like 5 minutes within each other, and the prices were different. You know, so that's again, you know, and for these online markets, they even put an additional feature where they actually say, if for you to be able to buy a good and service, you have to register, so that we can be able to see your price elasticities over a period of time, for a long time. So now with the advent of flexible manufacturing, which will also make the supply curve much more flexible and individualized goods, other than goods and services that are based on aggregate characteristics, then we are going to see that indeed pricing is going to change, and demand and supply is going to be much more individualized. The second theories that we have actually talked about, and these are two different theories by the way, but we put them together and you'll understand why. The first one is a controversial one called the theory of rational expectations. And the theory of rational expectations actually originated from the theory of adaptive expectations, which was really an auto-regressive model. So what does this mean? If you wanted to find out what the temperature is going to be tomorrow, you use the temperatures of of previous histories of that particular variable. So you predict the future variable based on your history of the past variable. And of course, people make assumptions that whatever impact on that variable will be reflected by the variable. I think even the efficient market hypothesis makes that assumption, that price actually incorporates everything that impacts on it. So what was the problem with the with the theory of adaptive expectations is that his predictions of the future actually is biased. And because of that came the theory of rational expectations, which basically says that agents are never systematically wrong on predicting the future. It turns out that they can be systematically wrong, especially if those agents are human beings. They can certainly be wrong. Now, what happens with the advent of artificial intelligence and big data? It means when we are able to predict these future expectations of whatever variables we are looking at, we can now go to the internet and look at almost everything. We can even handle thousands and thousands of variables. And what does it do to that? It does two things. Number one, it reduces the bias. Number two, and we have done the experiment, it actually reduces the variance of our expectations, which is actually quite good. You can see how artificial intelligence is changing that theory. And then the second one is the theory of rational choice. The theory of rational choice basically says that agents make a choice that maximizes utility. This is utilitarianism. It has been written quite widely by John Stuart Mill. You can read his article on this. But now the problem is that when you are making a decision, you actually do not know the future. So what do? You have to predict the future. You know, again, as I have explained when I was explaining rational expectations, now you can be able to use information in the internet in order to make the prediction of the future. The other theory that we looked at is bounded rationality, one of my favorite subjects. This theory came up with a gentleman called Herbert Simon. Herbert Simon is probably a person who epitomizes multidisciplinarity. He obviously was not an economist. He actually did a PhD in political science. And he is actually one of the fathers of artificial intelligence. And that is why he also won a Turing Award, which is the highest award that a person can be awarded in computer science, a $1 million prize. So what Herbert Simon said, he was obviously criticizing the theory of rational choice, which basically says that when people make predictions, they make predictions to maximize their utility. Then he says, but the problem is that people do not have all the information to make such a decision. That was the first criticism that he placed. He says, but even if they have all the information that they need in order to make a decision, they cannot be able to process that information. So if I were to give you a simple example, that if it is cloudy, take an umbrella when you go outside. If it is not cloudy, don't take an umbrella. It's a simple algorithm, then you need to observe that. But if I were to give you 100 variables on when to take an umbrella and when not to take an umbrella, you will not be able to use it. Human beings cannot be able to handle multiple variables at the same time. You will have to do some form of machine. So you see, Herbert Simon said, no, even if we give you all the information that you need to make a decision, if it is a human being making a decision, it's not going to be a good decision. Then he also said that we don't even have the perfect processing time, and therefore we can't make a rational decision. Because rationality also includes the time in which to execute a decision. You agree with me that it is not rational to do that which you can do in 5 minutes in 25 hours. Because it's not optimal. So now, what Herbert Simon concluded was that rationality, therefore, is bounded. And what is bounded because of information, processing time, and the ability of the brain to process all that information. Now what happens if all those decisions are made by an artificial intelligent machine? Firstly, it is able to handle more information than we have ever thought about. Secondly, it can be able to go to the internet and probably be able to process millions and millions of entries related to that particular decision. And thirdly, it can be able to do this very fast. In fact, year after year, it does it faster because in computer science, you have a law called Moore's Law, which tells you that processing power actually doubles every 2 years. It's a law. It has been going like that for over 50 years. So it can, you know, which means that, you know, if you are going to use an artificial intelligent machine this year, and then you go and use it in 5 years' time to solve the same problem, in 5 years' time, you will be able to execute that decision faster, more slow. So what does this mean to us? It means that, no, these bounds that Herbert Simon actually prescribed are actually, in fact, flexible. They are flexible depending on advances of technology. They are flexible depending on the scale of the data that is in the internet and the ability to process that data. Are we still on the same page? And then we talked about another theory called, this is in behavioral economics. The principal objective of artificial intelligence in economics is basically to scale back the claims that behavioral economics pronounces. Because behavioral economics basically says that the market is going to have certain characteristics simply because the people who are participating in it are human beings. Now, what happens when they are no longer human beings? They are artificial intelligent machines. It obviously means that the decisions that are going to be made are going to be truncated as far as the influences of behavior is concerned. Prospect theory was proposed by Kahneman and Tversky. They wrote a book, Kahneman wrote a book called Thinking Fast and Slow. This is not the book that they wrote. This is actually the shorter version of it. You can go and read this. How many of you have read Thinking Fast and Slow? So they spent quite a great deal of time talking about the way human beings think. They are saying that no, when a human being makes a decision, firstly, there is the first part. We make decisions based on, somebody asking a question that you just answered. And then there is the slowest part. For example, if I ask you to find the square root of 17, you probably think slower. And he says that, thirdly, when they make these decisions, human beings, they do not use logic. They actually use rule of thumbs. And as a result, the conclusions, they actually distort the market. And the reason why they titled the book Thinking Fast and Slow is obviously because there is the first things that you decisions that you make, which are not obviously not very rational, and then the slow decisions, probably that they are rational. But again, what you're going to see is that as we migrate decision making to machines, which is what we are doing, then we are going to see that machines is not going to think slow. We'll always be thinking fast and fast. So if Kahneman was writing about a decision maker that is a machine, he probably would have titled this book Thinking Fast and Faster. And this is probably a picture depicting. So you have bounded rationality. These are the bounds that were imposed by, as prescribed by Herbert Simon. information, processing time, and ability to make sense of the data. Then you have prospect theory that says that no, the human being does not even use logic. And as you can see, the area under that, which is the probability of making a rational decision, is lower. So once we start having artificial intelligence, obviously, we are moving the bounds outside that circle for more rationality. And the impact of that is actually quite. Now, the other theory that we considered was information asymmetry. Akerlof and Stiglitz and Sargent actually won Nobel Prizes for this. How many of you have read the article Markets of Lemon? It's a fantastic thing. So basically they use two examples. You know, if suppose you are a buyer of cars and you have two salesmen. One says good cars and another one says bad cars. And you don't know because of information asymmetry. And then if you go to a good car salesman and you say, how much does this car cost? And he says, it costs 50,000 rands, probably it's not a very good car. And you say, please give me a discount. He probably is less willing to give you a discount, isn't it? He's selling good cars, but you don't know. He probably says, I'll give you 10% discount. You go to a bad car salesman and you say, please give me a discount. I'll probably give you 50% discount. And what they found out was that because of this information asymmetry, the fact that you don't know which one is which, you actually drive away the good car salesman. And their conclusion was to say that information asymmetry actually impairs the market. We all know that the market now is becoming much more online. And much more of this buying and selling is going to be done online. And this buyer, artificial intelligent robot, can be able to access all the information that has ever been written about buyer one and buyer two. So what is the conclusion out of this? The first conclusion is that artificial intelligence in the market actually reduces the level of information asymmetry. And the second conclusion is that it actually reduces the amount, the volume of trades in the market. Because information asymmetry, it turns out, is actually a necessary condition for exchange of goods. So if you have a cell phone and I have 1,000 rands, for you to take my 1,000 rands in exchange of a cell phone, the 1,000 rands must be much more valuable to you than at the cell phone. And for me to give you the 1,000 rands in exchange of your cell phone, the 1,000 rands must be much more valuable to me than that. So that's information asymmetry, and so on and so forth. So as a result, once you reduce that, and we have actually done a simulation in this regard, it actually reduces the levels of volumes of trade. We're actually quite happy to see that Cornell University is actually on their course called Econ 2040, are actually teaching this, our conclusions, as you can see. They actually rewrote this theory much, much better than we could ever have intended. But they did actually credit to us that, so this is quite exciting for us. Then the other one, you know, now it's becoming much more mathematical, game theory. This chapter Evan wrote, you know, game theory as we know. How many of you have watched A Beautiful Mind? Yeah, it's actually about game theory. John von Neumann actually came up with game theory. He did not win a Nobel Prize. What Nash did was to come up with a concept called Nash equilibrium. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the Nash equilibrium. So what happens in game theory? What happens in game theory is that you have players, and the players have rules, and they interact with one another, until they cannot be able to interact any further and increase their utility. It's almost like when you go to a market and say, how much does this phone cost? And somebody says, 1,000 rands. And you say, no, I only have 500. I'm only prepared to pay 500 rands. Then it comes down, you say 900, and then you say 600, and then you go until you reach some form of equilibrium where you can see that any further negotiation is not going to result in any one of you being further satisfied. That is what we call the Nash equilibrium. This is what Nash actually won a Nobel Prize for. But what is the problem with game theory? The problem with game theory is that it only works when you have few players. You can do it with two, probably can do it with three, maybe even four. Once they start becoming many players, it becomes problematic. Now, how do we go about that? Now, you can actually do what we call experimental game theory, when you use what we call multi-agent systems. So each agent is intelligent. You give it intelligence using artificial intelligence. You give it rules that it has to play by. Then it interacts and you can be able to see equilibrium. It's actually quite amazing. You can actually be able to get softwares that are able to do this, and you can be able to see this. And of course, this allows us to expand the degree in which we can be able to exercise or to apply game theory and the quality of the results that we are able to get. And obviously the next theory that we looked at is efficient market hypothesis, the most controversial of them all. I was actually quite surprised that in a German newspaper they actually quoted us. For those of you who can read German, you can see my name is there. And the University of Johannesburg is there. I quite couldn't understand why they were linking it to the University of Cambridge, because I'm no longer there. But somehow they felt it was But what the article is saying is, it is saying that we have concluded that artificial intelligence actually makes markets more efficient. Why does it make market more efficient? Well, we've talked about demand and supply, individualized pricing. We have talked about rational expectations and how it is improved. We have talked about rational choice, how it is improved. We have talked about bounded rationality and how it is improved. We have talked about information asymmetry and how information asymmetry is removed from the market. We have talked about behavioral economics, how it is almost eliminated. We are going to see less and less behavioral characteristics in the market, the more we are going to deploy these artificial intelligent agents. We have talked about game theory and how it is going to be improved. And the pricing, obviously, a consequence of demand and supply. Basically, artificial intelligence makes markets more efficient. And then this is another chapter that Hurwitz actually, Evan Hurwitz wrote. Mechanism design was, Hurwitz actually won a Nobel Prize for mechanism design. Not this Hurwitz. the originator of this idea is also coincidentally called Hurwitz. And in the book we actually make it very clear that don't confuse the two. These are two different individuals. He obviously is known to be the only Nobel laureate to actually be awarded posthumously. Nobel Prizes are not supposed to be awarded to people who are dead. But he died hours after it was announced that he won a Nobel Prize. Now, what is mechanism design? For those of you who are engineers, you'll be very excited about this, because this is actually a purely engineering concept. So it's reverse game theory. So in game theory, remember, you have players, you have rules. They interact until they reach Nash equilibrium. Now here, you have players, and then you have a Nash equilibrium that you want to achieve. And in mechanism design, is how do you design the rules so that the net equilibrium is what you require. Almost done. And obviously, it has been applied to the design of the kidney exchange, and it's quite clear. We call this control systems, by the way, in engineering. So I'm going to rush now. Portfolio theory, that was Evan Hurwitz's PhD thesis. Again, you can use those swarm intelligence, because when Markowitz won a Nobel Prize for portfolio theory, he made an assumption of stationarity. Professor Warren, you have written quite extensively on this. And what artificial intelligence does is actually to relax the assumption of stationarity. Stationarity basically means the character of your system is not changing. That's what stationarity is. Then financial engineering is obviously, you know, we are engineers, so when we are dealing with issues of finance, we call that financial engineering. And we have applied these things that we have talked about to simulation of the stock market, to creating a system that is able to estimate the risk of HIV from demographic characteristics, to how do we relax the assumptions that are made in the Black-Scholes equation. You know, instead, in the Black-Scholes equation, the assumption that is made is actually Brownian motion. Brownian motion actually came up with, it's a theory that was established by Einstein. Now you can be able to incorporate another form of artificial intelligence called fuzzy logic to relax the assumption of Brownian motion. And then the issue of counterfactuals, I'm going to skip. And then my very favorite topic, which is causality. The reason why I like this topic is because this is a topic that is very, very difficult. Hume, a British philosopher, spent a lot of time trying to define what causality is all about. Flow of information from the cause to the effect, the cause must happen first, and the consequences must happen later. And it is difficult because we often confuse causality with correlation. How do you separate causality from correlation? I think that is actually at the heart of studies in causality. Granger, who won a Nobel Prize in economics, came up with a causality called Granger causality. How many of you are familiar with Granger causality? Granger causality is actually correlation. We know it's not causality. Everybody knows it's not causality. And then he also came up with co-integration. If two signals are non-stationary, and you subtract one from another, and when you subtract one from another, the resulting signal is stationary, then there must be a causal relationship between the two. That was the conclusion. Actually, won the Nobel Prize for co-integration. Again, that is not enough. In artificial intelligence, Judea Pearl, a famous person in artificial intelligence, came up with something called Pearl causality, where he introduces a form of calculus called do calculus. You know, for example, if you wanted to find out the probability of whether you wanted to find out whether HIV causes AIDS, the big debate in South Africa, then you have to, probability of AIDS given HIV is not enough. You know, what you need to find out is probability of somebody being infected, given the fact that they, and that is not legal. So he spent quite a great deal of time trying to sort out this. So what is our contribution to this? We are saying that if you look at co-integration, it works very well if your system is linear. It works very well, even greater causality, it works very well if your system is linear. How do we move that into non-linearity? Neural networks are actually able to do that quite well. One more minute. It's almost the last slide. The last slide is what we call Lewis development theory. How many of you know Lewis development theory? It was proposed in the 50s. Arthur Lewis from actually the Caribbean island, an island called St. Lucia, which apparently has the highest density of Nobel laureate, won a Nobel Prize for this. He was actually developing a model as to how the countries develop. So he had this model where you have two group of two economies basically in one. One is developed, one is underdeveloped. And then he says, how do you develop the underdeveloped one? You keep on putting, migrating labor from the underdeveloped one into the developed one. Then you expand the productive capacity. Instead of paying bonuses, you reinvest it into capital, and then you move until you can no longer move. And at that point, the price of labor starts going up. And this is actually what the Chinese are doing. They're basically taking people from agricultural economy and migrating them into a developed economy. And we know that, according to studies, that they actually reached their Lewis curve in 2009. And that is why now you are starting to see the prices of labor, the cost of labor going up. Now, how does this link to artificial intelligence? We also have a little migration of labor. But that migration of labor is not from the underdeveloped economy to the developed economy. It's actually from the economy itself to machines. Much of the work that is actually being done by human beings is now increasingly being done by machines. And again, we are going to reach our limit curve, which is when we have reached a point where we can no longer be able to migrate labor to machines in a cost-effective manner, in an economic manner. Thank you very much.